At the end of last season, when I serviced the engine on Zephyr 4, I noticed that the heat exchanger had been leaking and looked a right mess. I didn't have time to deal with it right then, so here we are in early March, all geared up to sort it out. The heat exchanger is buried behind this access door, and it looks just as bad as I remembered it. I've had some time to do some research and I now know there are four connecting pipes. This one carries warm coolant from the engine and this one carries cold coolant back to the engine. These two connect to the seawater pump and to the outlet of the L-bend exhaust. Before we can do anything, we need to close the engine cooling seacock and then drain the freshwater coolant from the engine. On this engine, there's a drain cock to access the coolant, and I'm using a suction bottle to suck the coolant out. There it is, and that's the last of it. Immediately below the heat exchanger is the starter motor, so I feed some plastic sheet underneath it to protect it, just in case there's a deluge of water as I disconnect the pipes to the heat exchanger. The service manual shows that the mounting bracket for the heat exchanger has one hole and a slot. The idea is that you remove bolt 9 in the hole and loosen bolt 5, which is in the slot, and you can then wiggle the heat exchanger back and disengage all the connecting pipes, whilst the exchanger is supported by one bolt. Lastly, you remove bolt 5 and remove the unit. Sounds easy enough, doesn't it? Well, that was it in theory. This is it in practice. Kneeling down in a small space, peering in through the hatchway, trying to hold a light and a camera, and fitting a spanner to nuts partially hidden by pipes and stuff. For those of you that are keeping notes, it's a 12mm spanner. Eventually, I remove the bolts without dropping either of them in the bilge and wiggle the connecting pipes free, and finally lifted the heat exchanger clear. I have to say, it was a lot heavier than I expected. And there it is. Note to self, if you do this again, have a bucket ready to hold the heat exchanger and catch the fluids inside, so you don't spill it on your nice varnished floor. This is the rear of the heat exchanger. It's obviously been leaking for a while, hidden from sight. This is going to take a lot of work. The insides are a bit grubby, as you'd expect, but nothing too bad. My kind friend Bill has invited me to use his workshop, so we'll take everything over there and get on with the job. I've stripped the exchanger down and I've cleaned off the corrosion with a wire brush, and now I'm removing as much of the paint as I can with multiple coats of paint remover. It's tough old paint though, and it doesn't come off easily. Then it's time to use some abrasive paper to clean off the remains of the paint and give a good key for the later repainting. Well, that's the outside cleaned up. Now it's time to remove some of the crud from inside using Ridline, a slightly corrosive liquid designed to do the job. It's a funny looking stuff though, needs to be diluted to 50-50 with water. Then you immerse the barrel and leave it for a few hours to do its stuff. I was warned, however, not to leave it for more than 8 hours. While the barrel soaked in the Ridline, I cleaned up the end caps and other parts ready for painting, occasionally checking the barrel and moving the liquid through it. Close inspection of the end caps showed numerous minor dents around the edges, probably caused by a previous worker levering the end caps off with a screwdriver. There are similar imperfections on the ends of the barrel. So I filled the dents with chemical metal filler. They will sand down nicely and give a good surface for the seals later on. So, what's with the mirror? Well, it's a flat piece of glass and an ideal support for the abrasive paper, while I gently flatten the end surfaces to ensure a good seal with the mating surfaces of the end caps. Slow and steady, checking all the time. At last, it's time to prepare for painting. Carefully masking the ends of the barrel and using screwed up paper towel to block the inlet and outlet ports. When I bought the paint, I asked the Volvo Penta man if it needed a primer, and he said no, but bare metal must be clean and grease-free. So I'm wiping all the parts down with a rag soaked in acetone. At last, it's painting time. This is the official Volvo Penta Green. It's very dense and covers very quickly. The plan is to apply three coats. You can overcoat in about 30 minutes, so it shouldn't take too long. Such a satisfying job this is. Time for reassembly. This is the replacement gasket and O-ring set. It's essential that you replace these when you reassemble the unit. It's quite tricky making sure this gasket fits exactly to the compartments and inlet ports on the end plate. There used to be a locating pin, but it is gone. So a dab of superglue will hold the gasket in place until the reassembly. First, I push the threaded rod through the plain end cap with its gasket and feed it through the exchanger. Then I attach the other end cap onto the rod. It's threaded, so it needs to be screwed on. Now I can pull the two end caps together by rotating the captive nut on the rod, frequently checking that the inlet and outlet ports are in the correct position relative to the compartments in the barrel of the heat exchanger. Finally, I give a final tighten to make sure that the gaskets are compressed and provide a good seal. I've just got to sort this little bit out now. It cost me the princely sum of £15 from Volvo. It's only mild steel. If I'd had the tools with me, I could have made one. It prevents the two pipes that go in these connections from falling out. I'm going to paint it before I fit it. The old one had virtually rusted away, and I don't want that to happen to this one. Now it's time to fit the mounting bracket. Before I removed it, I marked its position on the bracket and the barrel, so in theory, if I line the marks up and tighten it all up, it should fit okay. Reading the Volvo Penta service manual, you are advised to apply soapy water to the rubber O-rings before fitting. So here I am doing just that. So, now it's time to fit the heat exchanger back onto the engine. If I thought getting the heat exchanger off was a bit tricky, putting it back on again introduces a whole new level of stress. Trying to make the pipes, hold the heat exchanger, remember it's quite heavy, and fit mounting screws, etc., etc. I've speeded this sequence up a lot. and I did eventually get it fitted.
Well, that was quite a job, only because it was difficult to get access to it. And now I suppose it's time to put in the coolant. Just a quick word about coolants at the moment from Volvo Penta. I went along to my normal dealer a couple of days ago to get 5 litres of the green coolant and was told that he couldn't sell it to me. He could only sell it to an approved marine engineer because apparently there's some element in the coolant that is now considered to be carcinogenic, despite the fact that they've been using it for at least 30 years because this engine is 30 years old. He then said we really ought to go over to the orange coolant, but you had to remove all traces of the green coolant before you put the orange in because it coagulates. Apparently it forms lumps. And that's no mean feat on this boat in particular, because I've got pipes going up to the heating coil in the hot water tank. And I just didn't want to do it. It's as easy as that. So I had a shop round. You can still buy the green stuff online. Various people on eBay are selling it and directly from their shops. But anyway, I went round the corner to another marine engineer, Volvo Penta marine engineer, and there in front of the counter, they had a great row of 5 litre cans of the green thing, coolant. So I just picked two up, put them on the counter, said, "I'll have those, please." And he sold them to me. So there you go. So I've got one for the next time I have to refresh the coolant, which according to Volvo is another 2 years. This is a crazy situation as well. You're supposed to take the heat exchanger off and flush it out once every 3 years. And you're supposed to change the coolant every 2 years. But you have to get rid of the coolant in order to take the heat exchanger off. So that works out really well, doesn't it? Not. Anyway, that's the next job, is to put the coolant in.
5 litres of ready-mixed coolant, which is simply poured into the header tank. One of the easiest jobs in this episode. Time to start the engine. Open the raw water seacock and start her up. Oh dear, you can't really see this, but it leaks everywhere, especially out of the connection from the seawater pump.
Well, I've been on the boat for just over a week, and most of it has been spent on refurbishing this heat exchanger on the engine. I've done my best with it, but it still leaks. I'll be taking it off again today, and somehow or other it's got to be fixed.
Needless to say, I was more than a bit disappointed by this. My friendly marine engineer, who incidentally didn't want anything to do with my heat exchanger, told me that the soap water might be okay for a brand new installation, but over time the ports and pipes wear. So he always used silicone grease to lubricate the O-rings and also the gaskets. So I dismantled the unit once again, cleaned the mating surfaces, honed them on emery paper again, and reassembled using best quality silicone grease on both the mating surfaces and the gaskets. There it is, assembled again. Now to clean the pipe ends, lubricate the O-rings with silicone grease, and then put it all back together again.
Right, here we go. We put the first bolt in into this slot here, and then the heat exchanger can be back, but it'll be supported by this bolt, and then you can slide it forward and mate it with all the connections. That's the idea anyway. So here goes. Let's see if we can wiggle this in there. Right, we'll hold it there. We've got another bolt to put in now. It goes in here, and that'll be it, effectively. Just using a screwdriver to locate the hole. So I can see that needs to come up a bit. There
This is a real pain of a job. That feels good. Yeah, I'll be there now. Right, let's just check these. Yeah, they're all solid in there. Then we can tighten this one up now. I'm tightening these up quite tight because when the engine's running, these vibrate like the clappers, and this will come undone ever so easily. Nothing's ever easy with engines, is it? There's always something in the way. Right, that looks good. Now for the last one. That's this one down here. On the diagram, this connection here with this pipe goes up over there and is solid. With Zephyr 4, it's been installed in a slightly different way. And so we've got a flexible hose on here, which is not ideal. Anyway, we can plug it in there. There it goes. But as it stands, it can wiggle around. So what I've done is to, in the past, is to hold it in place with a cable tie. Anyway, there's a little gadget here, a little plate, 15 quid's worth of Volvo Penta plate, and that goes in on this end there. And this is to hold these two pipes in place, stop them popping out. Fairly important because these are the seawater pipes. So this is the pipe that's come from the raw water pump. So there's a fair bit of flow there, and this is the one that goes up to the exhaust elbow at the top there. So fairly important that they stay connected. Otherwise, you quite quickly fill your boat full of water. Here comes the tricky bit. Let's get this bolt on, this nut on there. There we go. This is a nylock nut. Right, ratchet spanners, aren't they wonderful?
As a temporary measure, I have used a couple of cable ties to hold the flexible pipe in position. I'm intending to make a bracket to hold the pipe without using any other pipe as an anchor point, something for the future. Well, is that a success? Sadly, not quite. The heat exchanger still leaks a little. Some transparent Gorilla tape and a stainless Jubilee clip have stopped it, but it's not a permanent thing. While watching the video, I realised that the end of the barrel is not completely round. It looks like it might have been dropped in the past. So I'm sourcing a used replacement, but we're okay for now, and I'm happy to take Zephyr 4 sailing soon.